Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
All right, tonight I wanted to talk about one of the three life themes. I will always talk in one of three areas, and that's faith, the Holy Spirit, or leadership. This morning, mostly I'm talking in the parable of the dog about leadership, about us obeying Jesus so that we can have influence in this world and have our own lives shaped up to be influential people. But and yesterday in the Man Day sessions, we talked about men and, again, more about leadership and things like that. The last time I was here on a Wednesday night, I remember I did the seven steps of faith. Tonight I thought I'd talk about the great Holy Spirit, the mighty third person of the Trinity, who is often completely ignored in church life, and in some places almost denied, as though we don't know what to do with him except announce him in the benediction at the end of a service. But you need to understand that the Holy Spirit has been sent here instead of Jesus. And I spent a lot of my early ministry life, every Friday, I would spend a day every Friday, because our church was so small, I would just get away to try and sensitize myself to the Holy Spirit. I wanted to get near to him. I just felt a drawing to become acquainted with the Holy Spirit so that if he was inclining me in a particular direction, I'd go there. Because it's very easy when you feel the Holy Spirit moving you somewhere, our flesh doesn't like it. It wants to do its own thing. And it questions and doubts those sort of inclinations, those moves. I mean, when you go to say something and it's not right to say it, the Holy Spirit in you, he goes, You ever felt that? And you go, you're going, And that's walking in the Spirit in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, they had the law on tables of stone. In the New Testament, the law is written in your heart. It's written in your spirit. The boundaries are in there. The boundaries were on a table of stone, but the boundaries are in here. And sometimes we crash through those, much to our own torment and destruction. We do things that are going to hurt us when we break that internal guidance and inclination of the Holy Spirit. So if we can become sensitized to it, not only to know what the Holy Spirit is doing, but also to actually do it. Because obedience is very different to understanding what is required of me, and then to do it, that's quite another thing. So to know what we're meant to do and then to go ahead and do it is what the Holy Spirit empowers us to do. He has come to empower you to live the Christian life. Now, I've got to tell you, the Christian life is not hard. It's impossible. You can't do it. You cannot do the Christian life. When Jesus says, forgive those who hate you, please. Can you do that? I can't do that. I'm a reasonable person. I hate people who hate me, you know, and I get upset with them. So then Jesus says, I start to pray and he says, forgive them. I said, I can't do that, God. He says, well, as long as you think you can't, you can't. I said, oh, Lord. Okay, in Jesus' name, forgive those people. Bless them with a brick. I find there's a power that comes into my heart as soon as I make the right choice to do what the Lord has taught. I say, I forgive him. I let him go. And then I'm free. I'm smiling. Oh, that's so much better. Because unforgiveness is like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. It's not going to happen. You're gonna suffer the consequences. But getting filled with the Holy Spirit empowers you on the inside. Empowers you to have faith when there's an impossible circumstance. I mean, it's easy to talk about faith when you've got possible circumstances, when everything's going well. But when things go impossible, when things become dreadful, you're gonna lose your house. Your husband's gonna walk out. Your wife's gonna walk out. When kids have done things, when you lost your job, when things are really bad, right then is the time to summon faith. You don't need faith when you don't need faith. You need faith when you need faith. When you got a problem, now is the time to believe. I believe, in spite of my difficulties, that the power of God is going to change the circumstance. And as soon as you start believing, you position yourself for the power of God to travel in your life. Woo! I tell you, I'm preaching, people. Okay, so we have a swimming pool down the back of our house, down the backyard, and I, you know, goof off in there every now and then. So if I go down there and I'm swimming around and you get a hair dryer and you plug it in to the wall socket, switch it on and throw it in the other end, I will feel something. Because water is a conductor of electricity. Faith is the environment in which the power of God can touch your life. But unbelief, if I stick a big block of rubber there, cut the wires on the hair dryer and stick it in one side and put my hand on the other, I'll feel nothing. Because it's an insulator. Unbelief is an insulator against the power of God moving in your life. The Holy Spirit moves with power. Now, Jesus went to his hometown where they did not even believe he was anything great at all. And it says he could not do any miracle there. Not would not, he could not. He wanted to, but he couldn't. God wants to do a whole bunch of things in your life, but he can't sometimes because of our unbelief about it ever happening. You've excused yourself, you've explained why it happens, you've said everybody else does it, you've tried to blame others and everything else, but tonight you can make a decision. I believe that God is going to move in my life and you'll find that power will accompany that faith and bring you a miracle, bring you a way through that you've never been able to see before. Okay, let me take you into this passage in Mark chapter 5 and verse 25. Now, a certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years. She had suffered many things from many physicians. She had spent all she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If only I may touch his clothes, I shall be made well." Immediately, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the affliction. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" So all the disciples said, "Lord, everybody's touching you. You're in the middle of a big crowd. There's people everywhere, all around you, touching you. And the fact is, we don't know who you're talking about, who touched you." He says, "No, somebody touched me with faith. Somebody touched me expecting that power was going to flow into my life. That power was going to come into my inner man. That power was going to flow into their body." And that's what will draw the power of God into your life. The reason I'm talking a little bit about faith is because shortly, in about 10, 15 minutes, we will pray and believe God to touch people's lives here with fresh oil, with fresh anointing. And the fact is that as soon as this woman believed that God was going to flow into her life, if she could just reach out and touch Jesus, he felt power go out of him. That means the power of God can be felt. You can feel it come into you, and you can feel it go out of you. As soon as she touched what? Him? No, his garments. The anointing is not nothing. It can get in your clothes. The anointing can get in your pillow. The anointing can get in that bed of your lost child, and you can pray and the anointing go into that bed. I've tasted the anointing in some people's cooking. Not many, but some. I've tasted the Antichrist in some other cooking. It's like some people are anointed to cook, and you can pretty well feel like the anointing's there. When I was a hippie, before I got saved, we used to have things called hash brownies. You'd eat those things and you'd feel pretty good afterwards. This is like 45 years ago, not yesterday, okay? So the anointing can be imparted to you. Before you think this is heresy, think about Paul with his handkerchiefs. And people would pray, people would give him the handkerchief, he would pray on the handkerchief, And they would take it, lay it on a sick body, and the person would come alive. Healings. In the Old Testament, there's a guy called Elisha. And he's an anointed man. He does twice the number of miracles that his mentor, Elijah, did. When he dies, they throw him in a tomb. They put him, bury him in his tomb. And as the years roll by, somehow the tomb gets exposed. And Elijah's rib cage is sticking up out of the sand. And there are some Israelites having a war just nearby, having a skirmish. And one of their guys gets killed badly, very killed. He gets like a sword through his chest, a spear through his neck. Arm gets cut off. He's got an eyeball hanging out. His head's half off. This leg's twisted around. I mean, he's really dead. I think, golly, what are we going to do with him? They say, we haven't got time to bury him. Let's throw him in the tomb of Elisha. So they pick him up and they throw him in the tomb of Elisha. He flies through the air. As soon as he hits the bones of Elisha, life comes back into him. Screws his leg back around, takes the spear out, throws his arm back on, punches his eye back in, walks out and says, hey guys, how are you? I'm ready for action again. True story. It's in the Bible. Tad embellished, you know, but the thing is, he came alive as soon as he touched the anointed bones of a man of God. What I'm saying to you tonight is that the anointing can be imparted, and it's meant to be imparted from one person to another, right through the body of Christ, through the laying on of hands. And as you come into the New Testament, you find that the Holy Spirit is given without measure to Jesus, but it can come in a measure. And people, we need this anointing. We need the oil of heaven. There were 10 virgins getting ready for the bridegroom, but 5 were wise and 5 were foolish. And the foolish ones didn't get enough oil. And the wise ones, they took extra oil. They got as much oil as they could so that they were ready when Jesus was going to come into the world and move. They were awake and they were alive and they were ready with enough oil in their lamp. Now, here's the thing. You got to understand that oil, when you got oil in your lamp, you will not burn out. People burn out when they've got no oil in their lamp. Christian workers burn out when they're trying to do the Christian work they're called to do on their own strength. But when you got oil in your lamp, it's not the wick that burns. It's the oil in the wick that burns. When there's no oil, the wick starts burning. And when we are trying to do work for God and we're not getting enough oil in our lives, filling up with oil, we're going to find ourselves burning out. We get angry, we get upset, we get charred in that wick area, and we find ourselves no longer in revival. So these 5 virgins and 5 wise, 5 foolish virgins, 5 wise virgins, they all arrive waiting for the bridegroom. And you know what? Their lamps are burning. It takes as much oil to wait as it does to work. And while they're waiting, they get together and they're talking. It's like 5 o'clock in the evening. They're expecting him there at 5:30. And so they're already there and they're all talking about how women do. They're talking, oh, I love your hair, I love your hair. Oh, I got your nails here, where'd you get them done? Oh, no, look at that dress you got, oh, high heels. Oh, how's that boyfriend? And they're talking about, and it's going on for about an hour. Oh, they're so excited to see each other. How you doing? How's your mother? Oh, it's incredible. Talking. Then it gets down to like 2 hours have gone by. There's only 5 of them talking now to each other. Now they're down to talking about things like investments. How's your investment going, you know? Boring stuff, you know, like, oh, you got a new job. Finally, there's only 2 talking because all the others have gone to sleep. It's like 4 hours. He's late. You'll find God always takes longer than you want him to. We should form a committee. Say, God, don't you understand? We're running out of time. That they're hardly talking on then. they turn into the snoring virgins. They're all lying there, snoring in their lamps. Start going out, the five foolish ones. And then the five wise ones' lights go out. Everybody's lamp goes out. And then somebody says, the bridegroom comes. They all stand up. Whoa, what's happened? What's happened? It's 11 o'clock at night. Six, seven. So the wise ones are pouring oil into their lamps, lighting it up. The other ones say, wait, we haven't got any lamps. It's going to be pretty embarrassing for the bridegroom. He's only got five. He had 10. Beautiful girls lighting the way for him. Now he's only got five. It's kind of going to be embarrassing for them because they're bringing dishonor to the bridegroom. They got all set up, but they didn't get enough oil in their lamp. They had some oil, but not enough. They've run out. And when you run out of oil, you can't light the way. You can't show the way to Jesus and bring him into the people's world that you're trying to bring him into. So they said, please give us some. They said, no, you got to go away and go and buy some. Pay the price for the oil. Because there's a price to be paid for more oil. That's called prayer, generally. There's a price to be paid for that anointing coming on our lives. As we reach out for God and we say, God, I want this fresh oil in my life. Get ready for him to speak to you about spending time with him. About turning off the TV and just sitting there and waiting. Saying, God, I need to be filled up. You can't have a changed life without changing your life. A lot of us say, yeah, I want my life to change without changing my life. A changed life means a changed life. It means you're not going to be doing some things that you used to do and you're going to start doing some new things because your life is changing. And in that change, fresh oil can come into your world. In the Old Testament, there's a story of Samuel when he comes to anoint under the direction of God, the new king. And we read about David's experience in Psalm 92, verse 10, where he says, I have been anointed with fresh oil. It's so important, people, that we get fresh experiences with God, that we're not trying to live off an experience we had with God 20 years ago, or 10 years ago, or 5 years ago. Bread is only good when it's fresh and it's been heated up and it's on fire. I don't know if you've ever had a man day when you've had sausages here, but I don't know if you've ever eaten a raw sausage. It's disgusting. But once you get fire underneath it and you heat it up, it's beautiful. You'll even attract neighbors. They'll come over and lean over your fence. They'll say, oh, I see you painted your house. You haven't painted your house. They want a sausage off your barbecue, you know? It's like, and bread. When you're out running in the morning, you smell bread in a bakery. Mr. Atkins, he can roll over in his grave. I'm going to eat some carbs, man. I'm going to have me some bread. It just smells so good. When you got oil in your life, your bread, the word of God is fresh. The meat that you've got is appetizing. It's not raw and uncooked. Dough is just disgusting. But once it's heated up with the fire of the Holy Spirit in your life, you got fresh bread that you're feeding people. It becomes awesome in their life. So David remembered that day. He said, anoint me with fresh oil. Because there comes a time where we need oil to come into our world and liberate us again and set us free and make us stop being so cranky and grumpy and burnt out. And that sweet oil, I love that song that the band did so well tonight, Your Presence, Lord, the sweetest of loves. What a magnificent song. I just sing that and open up my heart and say, in your presence, Lord. And I'm there. I'm transported through the veil. David knew what that was about. He got into the New Testament before it even turned up. All the other guys are talking about God wiping out nations and doing all this. He's talking about, I love the Lord. I'm so close. He's close to me. And I'm walking with him every day. He got into that oil, and that oil will take you into the holy place. But it started when he's about 15 years old. Samuel had come to Jesse's house Because God had said, go to Jesse's house. This one of his sons, he didn't tell him which one, one of his sons is going to be the next king. I want you to anoint him. And so Samuel, the prophet, the kingmaker, turns up and says, Jesse, show me your boys. So he says, Eliab, come out here. Eliab, come out here. And so Eliab comes out strutting. I mean, he's muscles. He's big. He's like me. And he just strut. You're cruel. You've changed, people. You know, it's like, it used to be nice. So he poses down. He does the, he flexes. And everybody's looking at him. Samuel hears from God. The man's a pinhead. Get him out of here. He's not going to be taking the kingship. So he walks him out. Next guy comes in. He's sharp looking, pinstripe suit, briefcase. He says, I'll fix the economy. Says, no, this guy's, he's not the guy. Okay, put him out of here. All of them parade before the kingmaker, Samuel. And he says, the Lord hasn't said it's any of these guys. You got any other son? He says, of one kid, boy, I mean, he does the servant's job. He's looking after sheep, for goodness sake. He likes it. He's not a soldier. He's not smart with the money thing. Samuel, I hate to say this, but he writes poetry, and yeah, he's a cute little boy. He's like, you know, gorgeous kid. He plays a harp. And he just goes off and sings. And sometimes we've seen him dancing. I mean, it's like, not the picture of a king I think the nation needs. You know, Samuel says, call him. Call him. We're not going to go anywhere until he's been here. So they say, call David. All the servants said, David? He could be anywhere. He goes for miles, for days, 3 days away on this estate. He never takes his cell phone. He hasn't got a fax machine. He's got no nothing with him. How are we going to find him? I don't know. Find him. So they all run. Boom, 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 boom. Through the valleys, up the mountains, around the forest, through the trees, over the desert with a horse with no name. They're going everywhere, all over the country. And they... Finally, one of them, after a day of searching through the night, in the morning, sees this little figure leaning up against a tree, saying, I exalt thee. Little sheep, I exalt thee. He's hear his voice. David! David's gone. What's that? David! What? Oh, he says, hey, Elijah, how are you? You know, Hanamiyama, one of those names. Yeah, how are you? They tell me what you're doing. He says, what? Oh, stay there. I'll come up. And then he runs out. David, why don't you take your cell phone with you? We could have found you so easily. David, you need to go back to the house. Samuel's there. The prophet is there. On the inside of Samuel's heart, of David's heart. His heart starts pounding in his chest. Boom. He feels destiny, wheels turning. He runs down the hill. He says, you look after the sheep. The guy says, you go, go, go. So he's running. He says, I know a shortcut back. Goes through the river, through this little forest, through the little green pastures. Boom, he's over the back fence. Boom, over the next fence. Boom, over the next fence. Goes through the back door, comes into the front lounge. There's a courtyard there. All the brothers are sitting around. There's Samuel there. David walks in the room. As soon as he walks in, the Lord speaks to Samuel. This is the man. Fill your horn with oil and anoint him. Samuel walks across the room, filling his horn with oil. Walks straight towards the boy. David's just standing there. He tips oil on his head. It hits him. Like golden oil from heaven, his mind fills with visions. He starts to see into the future. He's spinning around that room. finally he collapses on the floor, and as he falls, he sees through into the future. He sees himself on a horse in slow motion galloping through enemy lines, slaying all these Philistines. He sees himself on the same horse riding into a palace. The next thing, he's on a throne, crowned as a king. He can't believe it. He sees further down through history, and then he sees into the city of Jerusalem. There are people crying out to a bearded figure who's got sandals on his feet. They're saying, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on us." And he's reaching around, and the healed eyes are opening. He sees even further down into the heavens of heavens. He sees the key of David opening doors that no man can shut, and shutting doors no man can open. He sees the throne of his glory enduring forever. He sees the Son of God in all of his magnificence. The whole room is filled with the glory of God. David stands up. Everything transpires as he saw under that of fresh oil came upon his mind. The years pass. He becomes the king. He wins all his wars. He's sitting at the desk. It's Psalm 92. We're well into the history of David. And he's writing there, it crosses his mind, that memory of that day when Samuel the prophet poured oil on him. Pushes himself back from his desk. He's been writing, doing a lot of administration, management. He remembers that touch. As he sits there just thinking about God, he says, "Anoint me with fresh oil, O God, in Jesus' name." Here tonight, I want that oil to touch you, to fill you. If you want fresh oil, I want you to stand up right now and make your way to the front and stand down here. Just do it in Jesus' name. Let the hand of God and the power of your Holy Spirit, Heavenly Father, touch each life here tonight with oil from heaven in Jesus' mighty name. I'm believing God for your oil, your presence, your power, your Holy Spirit to touch each one of these lives, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, Mariala Kapurudusho. Let's all just start praying. Can you just start praying? If you've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, just speak to God. But if you have, use your heavenly language. You may find, if you've never spoken in that heavenly language, that it comes easily to you right here, right now, as you begin to pray. I'm not going to have a chance to pray for every one of you, but I know that this fresh oil is going to come upon you. Simply as you come forward here tonight and present yourself before the Lord. Father God, let oil flow over every life here in Jesus' name. Come on, people, close your eyes, open your heart, lift your hands, reach out to God. Let fresh oil pour into your spirit. There's anointings for everything. There's anointings for motherhood. There's anointings for fatherhood. There's anointing for business. There's anointing for working miracles, for healing the sick, for prophesying, for teaching, for helping in the church, for volunteering. Whatever you feel you're not adequate for, let the anointing fall on that area. You're going to become brilliant as a father, as a mother, brilliant as a business person. If you've made mistakes in an area, it proves that in that area you're weak. But in my weakness, I'm strong because the power of Christ can rest on that area. In Jesus' mighty name, here it is. That's oil right now, people. The oil of heaven has fallen on you. The oil of God is coming on your life. Engage your spirit, my friend. Don't just say words with your mouth. In your heart of hearts, want God. Desire God. Desire to be near to Him. Don't be distracted. Take advantage of the moment. It will pass in another 2-3 minutes. Take advantage of this moment right now. You're on an altar. Don't be casual. Don't be lethargic. Don't be casual about it. Stir your heart up. Lay hold of God. Draw near to God and I will draw near to you, He says. Alara boloro du golo maranda. Tisele la bala la boloro barandasti. There it is. Fresh oil. I tell you, it's flowing right now. That oil of heaven is flowing on people's hearts, heads, and minds. Right here, right now, over your life in Jesus' name. There it is again. It's the power of God flowing. Some of you haven't prophesied for a long time. You got the gift of prophecy. Some of you are intercessors and you haven't interceded for a long time. The gift is coming on you. The strength of God. Fresh oil stirs it up. There are youth leaders right here tonight. The power of God is coming on you. It's going to expand your youth ministry. In fact, there are people here who are not yet youth leaders, but you're going to become youth leaders. The power of God's anointing is on you. Some of you are going to become children's ministries, family ministries. The Holy Spirit is putting gifts in people's lives here tonight. You're going to go out of this house tonight equipped with a gift, equipped with power from on high. Let's lift our voices in a fresh wave of prayer. Come on, storm it in there. Just go in there. Just go in there. Power comes onto these lives. Anointing comes into every heart. Power touches these lives. Holy Spirit, there's no one like you. Let an impartation. Great Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. O shiki parata sikela papaprata sikla mohombrata sikela bahata kaparata. In your presence, Lord,
there's nothing worth more.
Right now, we're just going to sing in a heavenly language, free worship, spiritual song to the Lord. Sing in tongues. Just reach out to God. I will worship and adore you, Lord. Let's lift our voices a little higher. Draw near to God and He will draw near to you. Oil flows on His place tonight. Some of you will see visions right now. Some of you will find yourself, the Spirit is activated, soaring like an eagle into the touch of God, into the presence of God. I will worship you, oh, oh, oh. Oh, Lord. Father, let the touch of God pour down on every heart here. angels from heaven surround every life. The fresh oil, the anointing, breaks the yoke, destroys bondage. Pour down here tonight. Oh God. Holy Spirit, walk amongst us. Great Spirit of God. Awesome thing just to linger in the presence of God. Power of God is healing some of you in your hearts, breaking chains in your spirit, breaking chains in your mind. Some of you have been depressed and a little suicidal. It's going right now. You're getting free. It's over. In the name of Jesus, you are free. Some of you have been struggling with all kinds of horrible things that are dragging you down. You got to know that the Holy Spirit is here to free you. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. Jesus says, if the Son sets you free indeed. And you're free. You're free from whatever happened in your past, whatever happened in your history. Everything's all right. Everything's okay. You're going to be just fine. You're going to be okay. You're going to make it through. The anointing is on you. You're going to reach your destiny. The Holy Spirit is with you. The great comforter. The great encourager. Lord, we love you with all our hearts. We thank you tonight for fresh oil. In the beautiful name of Jesus. Give you all the glory and all the praise, and everybody said amen. Lord, we love you. Thank you, Father. God, we praise and we worship you. Lord, we magnify and we give you all the glory. Father, we give you all the praise, all of the worship, all of the majesty. Amen, Lord Jesus. Can I ask you just to find your seats? Is that okay? Just for another 2 minutes or three, 4 minutes, we're going to be here. And, while you're finding your seats, let me say this. There could be some of you in this meeting, for whatever reason, you've never actually prayed a prayer to say, God, come into my life. Maybe you've been away from God. And really, you know what? It's time to come back. And it could be some of you who just you go to church, but you're not sure if you're going to heaven. Like you hope you are, you think you are, but you're not sure. If I was to ask you, are you going to heaven? You'd say, well, I hope so. I come from a Christian family. Or you'd say, I'm a good person. Or I'm in a Christian country. But none of those things actually get us into heaven. Christ in us is the only access to eternity. And so if you've never said, Jesus, would you come into my life? In a couple moments, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. If you've been away from God and you need to come back, I'm going to ask you also to raise your hand. If you're not sure you're going to heaven, I'm going to ask you also to raise your hand. So right now, would everybody close your eyes right across this auditorium? If that's you, my friend, and you're saying, Pastor Phil, I've never prayed a prayer that says, God, come into my life. Or you're saying, I need to come back to God. Or you're saying, I just really want to make sure I'm going to heaven. When I've counted to three, I want you to raise your hand. So you ready? One, two, get ready to raise your hand. Three, put your hand up high and say, that's me. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. Thank you. I see your hand. Thank you. 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 Who else is there? Would you raise it high? Say, Phil, pray for me tonight. I want Jesus to come into my life. Power of God is in this place. Thanks. I see your hand. Thanks. I see your hand. Thanks. I see your hand. Friends, those of you who raised your hands, just in these closing moments of this service, I want to ask you to do something like everybody else did just a few moments ago. I came down the front. I want to shake your hand and pray for you. So when we all stand, just make your way to the aisle and come down the front, and we're going to pray for you. Let's all stand. Welcome these guys as they come right now. Thank you. Just come.
Just as you are.
Tonight.
Won't you come just as you are? Come and see, come receive, come and live forever. He'll give you life.
Is coming. Now's your moment. Now's your time. Come on. Don't hold out on me. Don't stay in your seat. Just make that move right now. There's a warfare going on for your soul. You're fighting on the inside. Come on. Yeah, yeah. Come on. Welcome these guys as they come. Friends, I want you to pray a prayer after me, which ask Jesus to come into your life. I feel like there could be another couple people out there. I really want you to come down here. Just come while I'm praying. Come quickly. Come on. Don't stay there. Don't stay in that seat. Time to come. Time to come to Christ. What's your name, friend? Mark, your life's going to be transformed here tonight, son. Changed for eternity. Changed for now and forever. In the name of Jesus. Hi, what's your name? Ray. Ray, the power of God's going to come on you. Yeah, this is your wife? Soon to be. How beautiful is that? This is your first time here? No, not your first, but your first time down here. This is good. This is good, Ray. She's crying. She's kind of happy that you've done this. You're obviously a really good man. Is there a date? There is a date. Wow. That's awesome, girl. I'm happy for you. Yeah, you look happy. Yeah, that's amazing. This is a good guy, huh? You're going to do well. It's going to work. I'm invited July the 5th, one day after July 4th. That's nice of you. I regret to say I'm not going to make it, but I'm going to pray for you right now that it's a beautiful marriage. Can you all close your eyes? Say these words to God after me. Dear God in heaven, I ask Jesus Christ to come into my life. I ask to be born again. Cleanse me from sin. Make me your child. I renounce the devil. I accept Christ as my Savior, my Lord, and my friend. Thank you, God, for saving me. Amen. Lord, let peace fill each heart. In Jesus' name, touch his life. Touch his couple. Let the marriage be beautiful in them. Lord, let it be long and fruitful until they die. Lord, they're going to commit to each other. What a magnificent marriage it'll be. July the 5th is blessed. Lord, bless this man. Bless this man. Bless this little family here. This little boy. Bless Mark. Power of God is on Mark. His life is transformed here today. Changed forever. Don't hang out with the old crew. Lord Jesus, touch. Touch. Touch, my good friend. First time here. Blessing of God is on you. You're going to have such a beautiful life. Make sure you start following Jesus. Come here every week. Mark, you need to not hang out with the old crowd. There's going to be a whole new crowd here at church that you're going to hang out with. In Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. You're going to make it, buddy. You're going to make it. You're going to make it. Just, that's all the Lord's telling me to tell you. Just choose new friends. They'll laugh at you. They'll mock you. They'll try and drag you back. Man, you can get out of Egypt and Pharaoh will send all his chariots after you to try to drag you back in there, but you know, fight the fight, just get out of there and stand with the godly people. Have a desire in your heart to be good, not to be bad. In Jesus' name, touch him, Father. Power of God is on you. Pastor Dan, what an amazing man this is. Married the most beautiful woman in the church and, well, nearly in the world, for goodness sake.
Agreed.
You're a smart man.
Pastor Phil, that was great. Yep. Guys, I want to talk to you real quick. Put a smile on your face. This is the best decision of your entire life right here, all right? It's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel waving at you right here. Pastor Joel's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on, okay? I'm going to let you know what he's going to do. He's going to give you some free stuff. A couple little booklets our pastors wrote to help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. You need to find out, what do I do now that I'm a Christian, okay? It'll help you to find out. It's easy and it's free. He's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church that we like to call a spiritual personal trainer. Basically, it's a friend in church, like I said, who's going to help you, a new friend. New friend who's going to help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord, all right? So we give away friends here at the church. That's just how we roll, all right? And then, as well, we talked about the Holy Spirit tonight, okay? And he's going to offer you, pray for you, to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, okay? He'll describe how that works a little bit, and then he'll pray for you. You're going to receive the power of God in your life. Be completely submerged in the Holy Spirit. Maybe tonight was the first time you encountered anything like that, okay? You're going to walk out of this place with that same power resting on your life, okay? So if you guys will make a left turn, then I'll let you come right back out, okay? Make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Praise God. Now, Pastor Sue, don't run off. Pastor Sue, don't run off just yet. Sue Roth, my mom, go ahead and go back there with them. Pray for the Holy Spirit just to support. Yeah, you, mom. Go on back there, okay? I'll send that Sue for that those guys praying for the Holy Spirit, okay? And I want to just open it up to you guys here. You know, we came forward for a fresh anointing. Some of you guys in this place have not yet received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You haven't received the gift. Maybe you haven't received your prayer language yet. You heard us praying and singing in tongues and you said, I want that. Okay? If you want that, Pastor Sue's going to be right up here. Okay? And she's going to just give some quick instruction. This is how this works. She's going to pray for you. Okay? And some of the leadership here, Teresa's going to stay. Reverend Bill Chaplin, will you stay and pray for people as they receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Some of the pastors will be up here too, okay? And we'll just pray for you. Dr. Kenga, if you want to stay and pray, and Beatrice, if you want to stay and pray for people to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you guys are welcome, okay? And so they'll be up here praying for people to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the one that does that. He's the one that gives gifts to men. You're going to walk out of this place filled, flowing in the power of Almighty God, okay? Isn't that good? Do you guys enjoy the presence of God? Enjoy the word from Pastor Phil all weekend?
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.